What I want to show you in this presentation is that velocity information is critical to a good interpretation, and having the right toolset to use the velocity correctly is essential. Here we have a 3D exploration dataset, with seismic time data but no wells. In the display is a map view showing an area of approximately 150 square kilometers. The dataset can be interpreted using inlines and crosslines, showing some very clear north-south striking boundary faults. We can also pick a top reservoir that is formed by an angular unconformity, and a base reservoir which bounds some bright reflections within the reservoir zone. Looking at both the section and map views, the structure looks promising, with dipping surfaces and good closure against the east bounding fault. Running some very simple attribute work, we could look at the amplitude of the top reservoir, which in this case doesn't show a great deal. But of course, we shouldn't give up there. Striking RMS amplitude over 100 millisecond windows through the reservoir, we can clearly see some bright areas running through the dataset, which is much more promising. These bright amplitudes have a channel-like form in map view, and when compared to the section, the features align nicely with the bright spots we noticed earlier. We have made great progress in interpreting our exploration project. The next step is to depth convert the data. Stack-derived velocity data from NMO processing has also been provided with this dataset. Using the section view, we can QC the RMS velocity that was given. Stepping through the inlines, it looks okay. It is smoothly increasing with depth, and there is nothing obviously bad about this data. Because this is an exploration scenario, and we don't have any other velocity information, we can use these stack-derived velocities as input to depth conversion. We can select the velocity data and confirm the velocity type as RMS. We can now apply depth conversion. Let's look at a map in TVDSS. The depth conversion is working, but is it doing a good job? Looking in the map view, we seem to have introduced new structure that was not previously there. Interestingly, where we have a noticeable change in the depth map, when we look at the same area for the RMS amplitude, we find there is a zone of low amplitude which abruptly truncates my potential channel. When looking at velocity, RMS is not a good option as it's too smooth. Using processes, I can convert the RMS velocity to interval velocity, which is much more geological. Now it can clearly be seen that there is a significant velocity change at the southern edge of the survey, especially looking in the crossline view. It seems there could be some sort of problem here, related to the input pre-stack gathers or velocities. Luckily, we have both the pre-stack gathers and the toolkit needed to analyze them. Let's open the image velocity picker. The current configuration is to pick a velocity function every 2 kilometers, as seen in the map and section using the circles. The raw gathers at these locations are NMO corrected using a range of velocities, and the traces are cross-correlated for each possible velocity correction to determine the maximum semblance. A velocity function can be interactively fitted to the maximum semblance to confirm or correct the calculated velocity. The red line shows the RMS velocity. The blue line shows the corresponding interval velocity profile. The section views can be used to simultaneously view both the seismic amplitudes and the velocities that are being picked, so that we can see any edits real time. On the right is the inline seismic amplitude. On the left is the same inline showing interval velocity data. Stepping through the inlines from north to south, the gathers are flat. The data looks good. When we display the last inline, we can see at first glance the velocity picks are okay. But on closer inspection, the velocity pick near the reservoir top is slightly high, causing non-flattened events in the gather. The high velocity would account for the poor depth conversion that we've seen, and once stacked, these slightly dipping events will form weaker amplitudes than expected, which could explain the RMS amplitude observations. It's not clear why the data was picked incorrectly, The good news is the data didn't come from Doug. The great news is that we can fix it. By dragging the knee point to a higher velocity, you can see the gather flex down. Dragging the knee to a lower velocity, you can see the gather flex up. Dragging to the maximum semblance, you can see the gather traces align perfectly flat. This has an effect on the stack data and the attribute map, all of which are dynamically linked. Watch closely as I adjust the second stack location. The channels jump out of the stack section. The amplitude map updates to be more continuous. A couple more edits in case you missed it. Adjust the velocity, the section amplitude updates, the velocity updates, the RMS amplitude map updates. This is real-time interactive processing in action. Once the velocity picks are corrected, the area to the south of the RMS amplitude map looks great, and the channel now extends all the way down to the south. When I select the depth converted structure, this also looks significantly better as we would expect. Interestingly, as we look more closely at the depth structure, it seems much flatter, and the closure seems to have moved to the west. In time, we had very clear update closure to the east. Let's get a quick estimate of the gross rock changes to determine if it's worth proceeding with this prospect. I can capture the time structure closure as a polygon. I can use this polygon to isolate the updip structure to see the prospect more clearly. I can use the polygon to measure the enclosed area, and I can create a rough estimate of gross rock volume by assuming time and depth structure have a 1-1 relationship at this depth, and defining in an average thickness of 25 meters. The area is approximately 7.5 kilometers squared. The rough gross rock volume is approximately 190 million meters cubed. In depth, the structure seems much flatter, and the structure has moved to the west. Again, I can capture the depth structure closure as a polygon. I can use this polygon to isolate the updip structure to see the prospect more clearly. I can use the polygon to measure the enclosed area, and I can create an estimate of gross rock volume by defining an average thickness of 50 meters. The area is approximately 33 square kilometers, 4 times larger. The rough gross rock volume is approximately 1,600 millimeters cubed, 8 times larger. In this study, the velocity model changed the structure, which can often happen. In this case, it appears to have improved the gross rock volume, enabling me to continue with this interpretation. In conclusion, sometimes we're not given much data, and sometimes the data is incorrect. Using integrated tools, you have the ability to view the data in different formats, such as time depth, RMS velocity, and interval velocity, in order to determine the problems and fix them, therefore allowing you to deliver the best interpretation possible. If you have questions or would like to discover more, then visit our website at www.doug.com. And remember, have fun with Insight!